Hello friends and welcome back to the channel. In today's video, I'll finally find some scuds in the wild. I'm showing you how I get them into my resurrection jar and how I acclimate them to the tank water. And let's jump right into it. My journey started at the shore of the Neckar River here in my hometown in Heilbronn. I saw some very interesting animals, some larger animals than we usually discuss here on the channel. And I also noticed something very interesting. If you look closely here, these are Nile geese. They are not originally from Germany, they are from Egypt. And they have babies, and this is very unusual for the winter time. But maybe one of you has a possible explanation for this. Why they have offspring so late in the year when it's actually freezing outside. And that would be very interesting to know, yeah, or to find out. I will show you how cold and how freezing it is in a minute. I'm standing here at the moment with my t-shirt, and here you can see shot from the benthic area of this lake, of the Neckar River. As I said, it's like an artificially created pond here, and yeah, it is really cold. It is really, really cold. This is ice that is on the surface of this water. And here again, a shot from below with the GoPro here. It's crystal clear. If you look at it from above, it doesn't appear to be that clear, the water, but it's actually really clear. And what I'm hoping to achieve with this is multiple things. Of course, I want to find the scuds that are going into the large ecosystem tank. I also want to get beneficial bacteria, beneficial microfauna, basically. There might also be some worms in there. I don't know it yet. Or actually, well, while I'm recording this, I know it. I will show you guys later what's in this water, in this sediment here. At the moment, nothing moves here. Like, I looked at it for several minutes and there's really nothing moving in there because it's freezing cold. It's like 4 degrees Celsius, I think. So that's usually how cold the water is during the winter, that is not frozen yet. 2 degrees maybe, or even close to 0 degrees Celsius. I don't know how much that is in Fahrenheit. I will Google that later. These are the leaves that I was going for. So these are just leaves from plants that grow on the shoreline, but also from trees that are growing around this shore here and that fell into the water. I learned from the Father Fish YouTube channel, which is one of the best YouTube channels if you are into aquatic animals and stuff, natural style ecosystems basically, that if you have leaves in a pond and it doesn't really matter what time of the year it is, then there will be scuds in there and all sorts of aquatic life. And for me, it's hard to imagine at this point because I don't see anything in there. You can see nothing is moving there. In the summertime, there would be insects, small crustaceans, small fish, maybe even fry all over the place. But now it really looks like a bucket full of dirt. I would say that's the best description that I have. But as you will see later in this video, it is filled with life, really. I was completely blown away by what I already saw when I brought it home. And I'm showing you this in a minute. So first step with the glass here. I reused this glass from another project that I showed before. It didn't work out so well. I'm filling it up just with normal sand. Just a basic sediment layer. Just sand. And then I add some random aquarium plants that I just cut off and couldn't or didn't want to propagate in my tanks anymore, because my tanks, I mean, this is sort of a luxury problem. There's too many plants in there by now. For the animals, it's amazing, but I also want to see something within my tanks. So I'm using these plants now in here, and you will see later that they really didn't do well for several reasons. And the most obvious reason, I think, is that I'm adding this water here. These plants are tropical plants, basically. And I'm adding water that was almost freezing. You can't see how cold it is yet, but it's still almost as cold as when I took it out of the Neckar River. And you remember that there was ice, how to say, shells on it. And it's still extremely cold. And you will see in a minute how cold this water really is when you see that small water drops form on the outside of the glass, which is just evaporation or evapotranspiration, basically, that is happening. And you can see already here that I'm just taking all of the stuff that I took from the Neckar before and just put it in randomly. I don't want to really go for a beautiful design here because all of this is going to rot. Remember, water is 4 degrees Celsius, which is roughly equal to 40 Fahrenheit. And that means that it's so cold that nothing really reacts in there. And what I mean with reaction, this is a term from chemistry or biochemistry, which refers to that something is happening biologically. So biology is based on biochemistry, basically. And if something reacts, it can change. It can degrade, for instance. And since everything was so cold, remember 4 degrees Celsius or 40 Fahrenheit, it's basically like in a fridge or in a freezer, nothing really, really happens or nothing really reacts. And since that is the case, or that was the case, the clock, so to say, stopped for these plants, or for these plant debris here. And now what happens is that with the change, or the sudden change to 25 degrees Celsius or 77 Fahrenheit, the empirical Van't Hoff's equation says that the reaction rate typically raises 2 to 4 times with temperature increases by 10 degrees. I don't exactly know how this translates into Fahrenheit, but if you increase something by 10 degrees Celsius, its reaction rate roughly doubles. That means nothing happened at all at roughly 0 degrees Celsius. And you have not twice, but 4 to 6 times the reactions that will happen when once it increased to 25 degrees Celsius / 77 Fahrenheit. And that means that this will rot very fast and it will stink, it will be disgusting, but this is also what happens in a swamp in the spring or summertime, right? Everything comes back from the winter, temperatures rise and things start to degrade. And this will be, yeah, very bad smell in my room here. But yeah, that's why it doesn't really make sense to look for a nice design here, because everything will degrade super fast and then the prettier design can come later. And these plants are just some duckweed and some algae from my larger tank that I put in because I know that they are hardy. They can basically resist any temperature, or not any temperature, but low temperatures to high temperatures. They are originally from Germany, at least this duckweed here. So I know that they will at least contribute some photosynthesis. They will deal with some of the excess nutrients that will be created by the life forms that are in there. And therefore, they are a good plant to add at the beginning, so they can contribute some oxygen. And now I increase the speed of this video to 50x, and you can see that nothing really happens at the moment. You can actually see the what I said a few minutes ago, that now on the side of this glass you can see some evapotranspiration happening, and now it starts to move. You can see it on the surface of the water if you look closely, that some animals are starting to do their thing. And that's very interesting, because as it gets warmer, they start to wake up, and for them it's basically spring. And that's what I really love about these micro ecosystems or microcosms. Everything works like in the big world, but on such a small scale, and you have a real ecosystem in this glass here. Fast forward roughly 1 week, and it's time to acclimate the water to the tank water. The original goal of this small glass is to get scuds for this large tank here, right? That's what the community wanted in the survey that I did a few weeks ago. You guys wanted to add scuds to this tank, So since I couldn't find scuds anywhere, I had to go to the Neckar River in ice cold water and get them with my bare hands, basically. And now with this technique, I'm trying not to get any guppy fish here, and I'm just getting some water from my tank. My fish tank has roughly 24-25 degrees Celsius, 77 degrees Fahrenheit, and by now the water in the tank, or not in the tank, sorry, in the jar, has also acclimated to the surrounding here, and you can see it's fuming with it's buzzing with life already. You can see a mosquito larvae there, a red one, and you can see all of these little scuds, the guys that we were originally looking for. You can see them on the surface here. I'm not sure if you can see them perfectly, but I will show some shots of the scuds of the freshwater isopods later. But first things first, let's add some tank water. I just want to add a small lid here, just some glass lid, and then I can slowly pour in the water, not to disturb too much the plant debris in this small jar here. I know these animals that are in there are supposed to be hardy. They are basically the first layer, the first trophic layer of the river, or of the shore of the river, of the benthic area, so to say, everything that is on the ground. But still, these animals are not used to tank water, not at all. They live in the Neckar. It's a huge river. It's one of the biggest rivers in Germany. I think the Rhine River is the largest river in Germany, but nothing compared to Amazon or Nile River or the Mississippi in the USA, for instance. Still relatively large rivers and completely different biological composition, completely different water parameters compared to my tank. My tank is completely filled with exotic animals, so it's a different kind of water parameters. That's why I gave the jar here, or the jar ecosystem, 1 week to acclimate, first of all, to the temperature of my room, right? These guys in there were in the deepest winter, at least for German standards, deepest winter, 4 degree water temperature, 4 degrees Celsius, 40 degrees Fahrenheit, so really ice cold water. And now they are more or less in a tropical, or at least subtropical, temperature already. And now with adding the tank water, it's getting even warmer for them. So this is like a shock for them, and shocks are always bad for the animals, right? Yeah, let's speed it up a little bit. This is now 50x again, and you can see that there's way more movement going on than 1 week ago. Also, what I want to do now is add some more plants. You can see actually a small animal on the right, or right middle side of this jar already, and I'm just adding my hardiest plants that outgrew most of my other tanks. The Hygrophila corymbosa stricta, I kept them in room temperature already. They do not good, but fine, I would say. So I'm adding them. They won't grow super fast in here because there's not a lot of nutrients. And I want to use this as a resurrection jar, basically. Of course, I want to cultivate the scuds in there and add them to my large tank, maybe in like a week or something. So stay tuned for that, definitely. And subscribe to my channel. That would be a good reminder now, because the scuds that I will show at the end of this video, they will get into the larger tank. But to give them a nice home, also with steady oxygen production, I just want to add some Hygrophila corymbosa stricta here. And the plants that I added at the beginning of this video, after 1 week, they were completely rotten and just died. So there's a lot of decomposition going on in this jar here. It really smells terrible. My fiance asks me every day if I took a shit into my place, because it really smells terrible. But that's what I anticipated. That's part of the hobby, I would say. Maybe I could have put less plant debris in there, but it smells like on a compost basically, or in a, I don't know, in a dumpster, an organic dump. It smells really terrible. Anyways, I'd do anything for my animals, so also I have to get through this with them. Now it looks already very green, I would say. I mean, it won't win a Red Dot Design Award, I'm quite sure about that, but it serves its purpose, right? It gives the animals a nice place to live until they can move to the tank, and here we have them. Here are the scuds. Couldn't find them anywhere on the internet to purchase them, but just as Father Fish said, they will be anywhere where there's leaves. Even in the deepest winter in Germany, you can find them just on the shoreline, in any pond, in any river, in any lake. And these guys are actually super tough to film. They are so fast, and I think that's why they are called scuds also. They just scud around the whole jar, and I really hope that I can put like maybe 10 of them, when they maybe have reproduced a little bit in the small jar here, into the larger tank, because I'm a bit afraid that they will just be eaten by my black molly. And the scuds are not the only species in there. There are bladder snails in there, and also these white weird animals. I'm not sure what they are. I'm quite certain that those are insects. I have one guess. Maybe you can write your guess into the comments. They move and behave like spiders. There are larger ones in there. I think this one is an early stage of a dragonfly larvae. And these guys look like straight out of a horror movie, to be honest. They don't really move. They are super slow. But I think that's because they are ambush hunters. And I watch documentaries about these guys, and they apparently are just waiting for fish to swim right in front of them and then kill them. Also, there's this sort of worm-like thing. I don't really know what species it is. And on top of the jar, there are the large guys. These are two dragonfly larvae. I'm sure that these are dragonfly larvae, actually, because they look like exactly what I found on the internet, and they look horrifying, these guys. Also, I cannot put them into my large tank because I'm certain that they will eat my guppies. Guppies would perfectly fit, and they could just munch them away, and I don't want that, of course. Also, there's a ram's horn snail here on the right hand side, and I'm actually looking forward to add them to my tank as well. Thank you so much for tuning in to today's video. Please consider giving me a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel. It really, really helps a lot. And I'm sure if you found this video interesting, you will love this video here on how I built my ecosystem tank in the first place. Thank you, guys.